consequences of the World War II had reached far and wide, and not least for us, the Palestinian people. Just 3 years after the end of that war, the Second World War, the Palestinian people met their own catastrophe. We met our own catastrophe. The creation of the State of Israel caused our disaster, our Nakba, when nearly a million people, more than half of our people at the time, including my own family, parent, grandparents, were made stateless refugees, dispossessed of our homes and our lands and our properties, and never to be allowed to return. Now, it is not my intention here to trace the history of our struggle, the Palestinian struggle, nor even lay blame here or point fingers there. But I do believe that our cause, the Palestinian cause, suggests what are the elements necessary to build and sustain a culture of peace. Palestinians and Israelis are alike, do provide a cautionary tale, if you may, in this topic and on this topic of a culture of peace. So I start with the Nakba, the catastrophe, because I believe that the fact that the fate of these refugees, now in our millions, has yet to be resolved, is one of the three fundamental reasons that our conflict has not been resolved. And therefore points to one of at least three conditions, in my opinion, that need to be met in order for peace to flourish. That is, in order to resolve conflicts, number one, we need to tackle head-on root causes. And I would like to really stress this. We need to tackle head-on root causes. Before we can do so, we need to understand and study these with an open heart. We must not try and sweep these issues under the carpet, because they may complicate our view of the world. After the horrors of the Holocaust, the world saw the creation of a homeland for the Jewish people, already promised decades earlier by the British government. And the world saw that as a moral necessity. But this homeland was to be created in Palestine, in my homeland. And the land's native population, my people, my family, the Palestinian people, became the victims of this project. Their disposition, our disposition, was and remains an unquestioned wrong. Unquestioned wrong. It is one of the fundamental issues at the heart of the conflict we still live with today. That is the reality. It is not neat. Reality is not neat. It is not simple. It is messy and complicated, yes, but it is a fact. And rather than pretending it did not happen, denying it did not happen, or that somehow we can ignore it, we need to try to deal with it based on the historical reality. Which brings me to the second element, which I believe to be crucial for a culture of peace, and that is, in order to lay the foundations for peace, we need to agree on a common moral and legal framework. You know, addressing root causes is crucial, important, but also having a common moral and legal framework is paramount. This is hugely important. It is why rules are a mark of civilization. Indeed, it is what distinguishes civilization from the law of the jungle. It's as simple as that. What distinguishes civilizations from the law of the jungle is the rules that govern us. Because without a common framework, without common rules, that is what we are left with, the law of the jungle. And the law of the jungle allows peace only as the absence of violence, as you have argued at the introduction of this discussion. And only when there is either absolute victory for one side or a balance of power between the conflicting parties, peace may prevail for a specific period of time. This is not what we envisage. Over the past 4 years, we have all seen a disconcerting reversal to something like the law of the jungle on the international scene. Much of this was encouraged by a US administration under Donald Trump that seemed to desire a simpler time where national interests always outweighed multilateral consensus building and compromise. A narrow, very narrow, nationalist suspicion of multilateralism as a sign of weakness, however, is a very dangerous route to go down. Indeed, it is the very route countries went down those 80 years ago that caused so much havoc, so much devastation, so much horrors. It is the very route that the United Kingdom, among others, decided they would cut off once and for all. They did so by erecting, they, the international community, they, the United Kingdom, they, the Europeans, they, Asia and Africa, they, the Americas, they, the human family. We did so all together by erecting a global system of rules and conventions that would govern relations between states. That would set rules for war. The Geneva Conventions, specifically the rights of people, and would particularly the right to self-determination, and would outlaw conquest through violence. You know, the premise of the rules-based international order was the inadmissibility of acquiring land by force and conquest and violence. It must not be forgotten what an achievement this global structure of rules was and remains. Embodied as it is, and, you know, sometimes also, I have to say, you know, less applied. But in the end, the characters of the United Nations and the various bodies and conventions and resolutions have really embodied, if you may, these rules and these conventions. And for the first time in human history, we have a common framework to which all states and nations, in theory, can appeal and under which our differences can be resolved in a fair, equitable, and transparent manner. Of course, it is a framework that has been specifically designed to be inclusive enough in its principles to appeal to all but the most extreme ideologies. It is both a common and a moral framework based on human rights and an idea of collective rights and humanitarian principles. It is not perfect, of course. It is absolutely not perfect. Nobody knows this more than us, the Palestinians. It is not perfect in part because it allows the world's strong countries an outsized voice. But in the end, it is an enormous advance on anything that has come before. Anything that has come before. It is an enormous advance because it allows everyone an equal appeal to justice as a way to solve conflicts. And a sense of justice fulfilled is crucial to your topic today, to why you meet today, to your forum, to your efforts, which is the culture of peace. And friends, ladies and gentlemen, this international order is therefore a human treasure. And I would want to stress this and repeat this. Our order, our international order, is a human treasure. But we need to take it seriously. We do need to take it seriously and treasure it ourselves. If we do not, if the rich and the powerful are simply allowed to bend these rules, these global rules, bend it to their well, if others are allowed to ignore these rules, we risk losing this global order. Like I say, it's not perfect. It can be improved. And you know the famous saying that the room of improvement is the biggest room. But we really don't want to lose it. Which brings me to the third condition, the third requirement, if you may, for a culture of peace, which is the willingness, the will to abide by these rules, to enforce these rules, to have a recourse to adjudication, to courts, international courts. A common framework gives us a way by which we can judge conduct and conflicts more broadly and find resolutions and solutions. But it means nothing if we are not prepared to abide by these findings. Nothing. Here, perhaps lies the greatest weakness of our international order. It works well when the world's powers or the powerful nations unite to take a joint action and a joint position. It does work well, our international system. It does not work well, however, when these nations are divided or when one or more of them decide to directly contradict the principles and resolutions of that order. A lot of cynicism about the rules-based global order stems from this very fact. And that is a fact. It is a fact, unfortunately, regrettably, but it is a fact. In the face of this, some have, like the Trump administration, resolved simply to withdraw from this order, as you saw with the World Health Organization. I mean, just at the start of a global pandemic, the United States of America pulls out of the international organization in charge of dealing with pandemics, global pandemics, and bringing us together. In effect, this amounts to throwing your hands in the air and simply giving up. Palestinians perhaps have more cause than most to be suspicious about the global order, that on the one hand seems very clear about what are our national and political rights, and yet does little to make it a reality. By the way, Palestine has the most international resolutions in the United Nations Security Council, in the General Assembly for decades, and they all remain unimplemented. We should rightly suspect or be suspicious of an order that is ready for over several decades to support that order, even if barely these days an agency to care for Palestinian refugees, even that, UNRWA, even as it does little to secure their rights and resolve their situation. I mean, even UNRWA is under attacks. Without UNRWA being an agency that implements the right of return, some world powers, primarily the US and the Trump administration, have attacked such an international organization that represents the very basic international responsibilities towards Palestinian refugees. Nonetheless, we are also very clear in our appeal to this order, precisely because we believe that for peace to be sustainable, it needs to rest on a shared and agreed framework of rights, transparent to all parties and resolved accordingly. Rules have to be across the board. And we are not giving up on the international order because it offers us a peaceful path to resolving our struggle and ensuring that one day, finally, the people of Palestine will be able to enjoy their freedom in a state of our own with full independence and sovereignty. And our refugees will fulfill their right of return and their right to compensation and their rights according to international standards. But also, this is bigger than the Palestinians and the Israelis, even our region. We live in a globe and there are so many conflicting parties. We are also not giving up on the international order because it is the right thing to do. It is the right thing to do. The global rules-based order is something worth fighting for, by peaceful means, of course. And to sum up, really, my friends, ladies and gentlemen, I think the Palestine cause shows us at least three conditions that need to be met in order to begin nurturing a culture of peace. The first, we need acknowledging and we need the knowledge and the understanding of the root causes of conflicts. We need to understand how conflicts arise and what continues to feed them. And we need to be honest and meticulous about these causes. No denial, no ignoring, no brushing under the carpet, no, you know, playing clever. We must dig deep, touch the hearts and the wounds of every human being. And the second, we need a common framework of values, a reference, a starting point. Otherwise, we are lost in the wonderland. We need that common framework of values to resolve such conflicts. Such a framework can then be applied to our knowledge of the root causes to offer us a way forward. So first we define the root causes, then we apply framework on these root causes. So if the root cause is disposition, we have rules. How do we deal with disposition, with refugees, with people who have been displaced? Why do you do so in Kosovo, but you do something different somewhere else? Why do you boycott and impose sanctions on this country if it annexes that land, but you don't apply it on others? That isn't gonna sustain our international order. It is my contention that we have such a framework already in the rules-based global order, based as it is on a fundamental notion of rights and equality. Equality among all nations, while not perfect, it is a very strong foundation. And a third, by way of summarizing, we need the political will and the integrity and the enforcement to either abide by the resolutions of that order or impress upon those who are reluctant and apply whatever pressure necessary to ensure compliance. In our case, the one word that has enabled failure for too long at achieving peace was the lack of accountability. It's as simple as that. Israel was put above the law, above the global order. It has enjoyed a culture of impunity for as long as it has been established. Since then, peace, my friends, a culture of peace needs to be nurtured by a sense of justice obtained, fair play, and a sense of wrongs righted and grievances properly addressed. That's my experience. That's our experience. It does need that. It does need a sense of justice obtained. Otherwise, no peace would sustain. We have to believe that justice has been obtained, fulfilled, attained, achieved. Fair play and a sense of wrongs righted. And there have been many wrongs committed to people, inflicted upon people. And all of people's grievances, including our people, the people of Palestine, needs to be properly addressed. This business, peacemaking industry, peace processes, and usually they are in disconnect with the grievances of people. You know, usually they talk about numbers and maps and no. It is first and foremost about my father. My father, who had left his home, who he was forced out of his home. Somebody took his home, his belongings, his photos, his memories. My father was made refugee more than once in his life. First, when he was just a young child, when the 1948 war happened, we went to Gaza, and I was born in a refugee camp. In the Rafah refugee camp, Shabura, to the very south of the Gaza Strip, I was born as a result. I was the outcome of the catastrophe. And I know I have sat with my father in many occasions to really dig deeper into his grievances, his wounds. Sad I am that he did not see the day when he is returned and when this has been addressed. He passed away only 2 months ago here in London. But I was hoping that one day his grievances and the sense of wrongs that have been done to him and his family and our people indeed would have been addressed before another generation is to actually endure that suffering and that injustice. And I need all this, my friends, all this need not to be a zero-sum game, Indeed, it can and ought to be a win-win. I assure you it can be a win-win. I come from a place of conflict of unresolved wrongs or continued sufferings. And yet, I'm hopeful. I am absolutely hopeful. I'm hopeful in part because of the example of places like Coventry and Europe generally. That is, there is a light at the end of the tunnel. Look where Europe was 80 years ago, and look where Europe is today. Look where Coventry is, the beacon and the capital of culture, European culture. The UK government has acknowledged Coventry for what it has gone through and what it is now spreading and radiating worldwide of inspiration, of that message that you all gather today for, the message of peace and the message of culture of peace. That peace with justice is possible. That peace with justice is possible. It has happened here in Europe, and it can certainly happen in Palestine. And that ultimately, that is a shared interest strong enough to take us there. Take us there. So thank you, and peace be upon you.